John Minardi.
All right. Perfect. Good morning. First time at New Beginnings. I'm getting a little feedback. Uh-oh, hold on. First time at New Beginnings. I've been invited many times by Dr. Kevin Jackson and Dr. Dubell, but I'm always speaking the same weekends as New Beginnings. This is the first time I've been able to come out, so I'm very, very honored to be here. I think it's very important for me to start off like this. I need you to know this. I'm a practicing chiropractor. Every day, I adjust people in my office. That's how I make my living. I make my living $45 at a time, just like every other chiropractor in this room. And any students in here? Give me a hand. Oh, holy cow, fantastic. Good for you guys, that's great. Good job. And just how you'll be making your living one day. I line up and adjust people every single day in my office. There's nothing that plugs into a wall in my office. The only tools I use are at the end of my arms. Okay, so that's what I do every day. I opened up my practice from scratch when I was 27 years old in a town that I did not know one single person in the town. Okay? Do you know what my marketing survey was to get into that town? I liked it. That was it. The end. What I didn't know was that I practiced just outside of Toronto, Ontario, in a place called Oakville, which has got about 180,000 people in it. What I didn't know at the time was that there was 90 other chiropractors already in Oakville. Okay? I could take a baseball in my hand and throw it, and within that radius, I could hit 5 other chiropractic offices from where I opened up. But I didn't care, because I always remembered what my mentor said to me, and I always remember when I sat in classes just like this at DE, when I sat in classes just like this with all the people that built gigantic successful practices, they always said the same thing to me. I don't care how many chiropractors are in your town. Doesn't matter if you're principled. It doesn't matter, you can build a practice. It does not matter how many other chiropractors are in that town. And I took that to heart and I said, I don't care. I'm opening it up. I'm going to tell the principals of chiropractic. I did screenings just like Dr. Cordero said. I was doing screenings every single week because I wanted people into my office. And I knew that if I could get people in my office, I had the skills to keep them there so that they understood chiropractic. And then something funny happened to me. About 4 years into practice, a patient walked in and asked me a question that changed my life in chiropractic, which then put me on a journey to doing a lot of teaching. At the time, I was already teaching Thompson Technique, but put me on the journey to teach what I want to share today, which is basic, practical neurology of what we chiropractors do. And this is the most important part. How to explain that to a patient so that they understand that we're more than pain, that we do so much more for them. And I wanted to be able to do that, but it all started off with a question. Now, this is my favorite movie of all time. It's Rocky, all right? If you don't know Rocky, I'd like to welcome you to planet Earth. It's nice to have you. But basically, the reason I like this movie so much, the original Rocky, is for this particular scene. And why is this scene so important for me? If you don't know Rocky, basically, Rocky, Sylvester Stallone, underdog, he's going against the champion. The champion is a far superior fighter, and he's beating up, and he's knocking him down over and over and over and over again, but Rocky wouldn't quit. But this one time, he went back to his corner. He just got knocked down again, and he went back to his corner, and he said to his trainer, "I ain't going down again. I ain't going down no more," is what he said. And what do you mean by that? See, he was frustrated. He was frustrated to the point where the champion was basically having his way with him. He was brutalizing him. But he went back to his corner and basically said this: "I don't care if this guy's bigger than me. I don't care if this guy's better than me. I will not let him knock me down one more time in this fight. Even if I don't win, I'm not going to let him do that one last thing. I'm not going to let him knock me down again." And that was a pivotal moment for me in my life when I watched that. Even when I was a young man, when I was 13 years old, the first time I ever saw Rock, I remember this scene in my brain, and it flashed back before me when this patient asked me a question. He walked into my office, I'm 4 years into practice, I'm in my early 30s, and he said, hey doc, and by the way, I was already doing good, man. I was already teaching Thompson Technique all over the world, I was building a big practice, I thought, man, life is great as a chiropractor. This is what I signed up for, it's what I wanted my whole life. And then he walked in, he said, hey Dr. John, have you seen this medical doctor on the internet bashing chiropractors? And at the time, I never seen this. And I said, no. I said, come into my personal office. So I walked into my personal office. I popped open my laptop. I said, show me where he found this. So he punched in a website called quackwatch.com. Okay? Now, some of you guys have seen this video I'm about to talk about, and some of you haven't, but I'm going to describe it. But the very first time I ever saw this, he punches this in, and a gentleman, well-dressed guy, good-looking dude, he's a medical doctor, who's talking to the lay public now. This is not other chiropractors, this is not medical doctors, this is the lay public, okay? And he starts off his presentation like this. He says, did you know that chiropractors can claim anything they want, but they can't scientifically give you a rationale as to why they do anything? And he had a whole bunch of brochures in his hands, okay, chiropractic brochures. We all got them in our office, you know, chiropractic and pregnancy, chiropractic and children, chiropractic and back pain, whatever, right? And he holds them all in his hand. He's got a big stack of them. He goes, look at this mess. He goes, they can claim anything. And he literally starts to throw them into the crowd. He goes, look, chiropractic and pregnancy, chiropractic and the elderly, chiropractic and cancer, chiropractic. And he was so flipping arrogant that I wanted to reach through my screen and strangle him on the spot, you know? I know, violence isn't the answer. Violence isn't the answer. But do we really know that? You know? I'm just saying. We could test it one more time. That's all I'm saying. Anyway, I used to be a professional fighter, so it's, you know, violence is first on my mind sometimes. Anyway, I'm watching this. And he goes on and on. And he pretends, like he's telling all these stories to this crowd. See, but the thing is, what bothered me, when he said something like this, chiropractic and pregnancy. And then the camera person zoomed in on a pregnant woman. And the pregnant woman had a look of horror on her face. She'd be like, ugh. And then they'd be like, chiropractic and the elderly. And then the camera person zoomed in on an elderly person. They'd be like, ugh. So in minutes of him talking, he had not only fear was easy. But not only did he have the crowd scared of going to a chiropractor, he was basically saying to everyone, if you're even considering going to a chiropractor, well, you must be stupid then. And he was doing this very, very fast and very effectively. He goes on and on. He sits back and he says, he pretends how he was a chiropractic patient, walked into a chiropractic's office and had all the signs of someone having a heart attack. And he said the chiropractor couldn't pick it up. And then he said a whole bunch of things. But at the very end, he says this. You're probably wondering, why does a busy medical doctor like myself travel the world to tell people not to go to a chiropractor? And he goes, you see this? He's got this big billboard behind him. And he says, that's the medical oath. And at the very end of the medical oath, he says, to protect the public at all cost. He goes, and I take that very seriously. He goes, if you go to a chiropractor, you're taking your own life in your own hands, and that's why I'm here to protect you, yada, yada. At the very end of it, he says, I have a challenge for you. If you are considering going to a chiropractor, I want you to do one thing for me and one thing alone. Ask them to scientifically explain what they do to you. And I guarantee you they cannot do it. He leaves. The camera person walks up to people at the end and says, did you like the presentation? Did you not like it? Whatever. Everybody loves the presentation. Everybody loves the presentation. What are the two most common answers everybody says why they loved it? Number one answer that come up again and again and again. He seemed very scientific. He used a lot of medical jargon. He impressed them with his words, okay? Second most common thing, he was passionate. Passionate speaker, and he was. He was engaging. He kept everybody's attention the entire time, okay? So then it ends, and I'm just kind of letting this wash over me, right? Because my patient's sitting right next to me. Then my patient says this to me. He says, hey, Dr. John, listen. He says, I'm a mechanical engineer. He said, so it doesn't really surprise me if anybody says, go to a chiropractor, ask him a whole bunch of science questions, and he might not be able to answer you. He said, because I'm an engineer, and I learned all kinds of science in school too, but I really only know the stuff I work on every day. So if you ask me stuff on that, I'm pretty good at that. But if you ask me stuff outside of that, I may be able to figure it out, but it'll take me a little bit of time. And I said, okay, good, we're on the same page. Fantastic, right? And he says, but you teach in the profession, don't you, John? And I said, yeah, but at the time I was teaching Thompson Technique. He goes, yeah, I read that on your website. So you could explain it, right? And I said, I'm sorry? And he said, you could explain how chiropractic works, right? Because you're an educator. And you know what I said? I bold-faced lied to him. I said, yeah. Oh, yeah. I could explain it. I could explain how people got pregnant under chiropractic care where they could never get pregnant before, because I saw that monthly. I could explain how people's immune systems increase under chiropractic care where nothing else did that for them, because I saw that monthly too. But I knew I was lying to them. I knew without exception that I was lying to them. Because do you want to hear how I explain that to people? Let me tell you, okay? Here it is. Bone, out of place, puts pressure on nerve, equals bad. Okay? I could use bigger words, but basically, that was it. Hey, John, how'd you get rid of my headaches? You see this bone? Putting pressure on this nerve. This nerve is hooked up to your head. I'm gonna take the pressure off the nerve, headache's gone. How'd my wife get pregnant? See this bone? Putting pressure on this nerve. This nerve is hooked up to your uterus. Take the pressure off the nerve, prego. How come my kid's colic went away? See this bone? Pressure on there. You get it? But I knew that was wrong. I knew that was dead wrong. Do you want to know I knew without exception that that was wrong? Because I knew people who were in chiropractic that all they did, every single person who walked in their office, all they did was analyze the atlas and adjust the atlas. And that's all they ever did. And headaches went away in their office too. People got pregnant in their office too. People's colic went away in their office too. I knew people who only did Logan technique, so all they did was put pressure on the sacrotuberous ligament on anybody who walked through their door. People's headaches went away in their office too. People got pregnant in their office too. People's colic went away. I know people who do Thompson who does nothing but full spine. And all this, I could walk into every single one of your offices. I will guarantee you that you analyze the spine slightly different. You adjust it slightly different. Yet all of you get very similar results. How come? How come? Because this is not what's happening. Bone pressure on nerve equals whatever ails you is actually not the power of chiropractic. That isn't it. If you take anything from my lecture, it's this. The reason we are powerful as a chiropractor and the reason it does not matter what technique you use to adjust the spine, the reason we are powerful is that we have a direct effect on the brain. This is the power of chiropractic. Every time you adjust someone, you recalibrate the brain. And because you recalibrate the brain, that is what allows the brain to then heal the body. This is what makes us powerful as a chiropractor. Can something actually put pressure on a nerve? Can a disc bulge out and put pressure on a nerve? Can a bone actually come out and put? That can happen. That's called neural compression. But you know how often that happens? Less than 10% of the time. Less than 10% of the time is something actually coming out and putting pressure on a nerve, which causes some type of radiation down the arm or whatever. That happens less than 10% of the time. So let me ask you a question, because you're all smart people in here. If it happens less than 10% of the time, why do we cling to that explanation in chiropractic? Why do you think? Why do we, even though if we walk up to chiropractors and say, that doesn't really happen on time, they go, I know, but explain it that way. How come? Why do we do that? What do you think? Because it's easy. Yes? It is easy to explain, and it is easy to understand. Can we all agree on that? Right? It doesn't even matter it doesn't matter how I say it. It doesn't even matter if you and I just talk the same language. What's my, like, listen, I'll talk caveman, okay? What are you going to do for me, doc? What's my problem, doc? What am I going to do? Right? Everybody gets that. Right? Everybody gets that. Everybody can put a plastic model, jam it on the plastic nerve, and people go, ooh, I see that. Everybody can buy those awesome looking things that, like, you push them and there's a green light, you push it again, it's a red light. Everybody sees the visual, right? But here's the problem. Here's the problem. We automatically go into a pain-based model, We automatically go into a pain-based model as soon as that's our explanation. As soon as that's our explanation, you automatically go pain-based, just like I did, even if you want to be the most wellness-based practice in your area. Do you want to know why? Because what did I just teach you? If you're my patient and you walked into my office, and this is what I just said to you, and I don't care what the symptom is, I don't care what it is, even if you walked into my office and said, I feel great, I've never felt better in my life, but my wife comes here and she just said chiropractic's good for my health. Fabulous. So what do you want? I want just be more vitalistic. I want to be more energy. I want to sleep better at night. I just want more life. We're going to give you more life. What's my problem, doc? What'd you find? I found subluxations in these areas. What the heck is a subluxation? Bone out of place, putting pressure on nerve equals bad. If that's my explanation to you, then what happens when I feel better? What happens when my energy's increased? What happens when the colic's gone away? What happens when the headaches have gone? What happens when what I've taught you is this? Why did you come in? You have a headache, you want to get pregnant, you have colic, whatever it is. Bone pressure on nerve equals this. If this is gone, if my headaches are gone, if I sleep better, if my energy's better, if the colic is finished, what do the people think is going on with that nerve now? Is the pressure still on it? Yes or no? So why do I got to keep coming back? You see, the challenge we have now, because I just taught you that the problem is bone pressure on nerve equals bad. So if the bad is gone, bone must be not putting pressure on nerve. Now it's very difficult to re-educate people on why wellness care is so important. The reason, so people always say to me, but I can't get rid of that model. It's so easy. The vision, okay. I don't want you to get rid of it. John, this is what I want you to do. I want you to add to it. Add to it. I want you to add this, because we're going to talk about this today. So if people come in, if you want to start with bone pressure on nerve equals, okay, let's change the wording of that a touch, okay? This is what I want you to put. Instead of bone pressure on nerve, I want you to say this. The subluxation irritates the nervous system. Irritates the nervous system. Is that causing your symptoms? Yes. And then I need you to add this. But I need you to understand that your symptoms are 10% of your problem. Your symptoms are 10% of your problem. And I always say this to people. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to downplay your symptoms. I'm not trying to say that this back pain is not debilitating you. I'm not trying to say that these headaches are not. They are. But I need you to realize that these are only 10% of your problem. So when I get rid of your symptoms, and I'm going to do that relatively quickly, you're only going to be 10% better. 90% of your problem that I need to deal with are these two things. Because of this irritation of the nervous system, you cause your brain to release stress hormones, and you cause your brain to release inflammation. You understand me? You have to bring stress hormones and inflammation into the conversation, because 8 weeks later, I'm going to come back to your office. I'm your patient. And I'm going to say, Doc, I feel great. I've never felt better in my life. Chiropractic is fantastic. I love you. You're the best chiropractor ever. But why do I got to keep coming in? Because I feel good now. Then you're going to say, John, remember our conversation? Your symptoms are gone. How much percentage better are you? You're 10% better. Because remember, the 90% that I'm going to be working with is stopping the stress hormones being released from your brain and stopping the inflammation being released into your body. Because it's those stress hormones and that inflammation that is actually being toxic to your overall health. The reason chiropractic helps with your overall health is because I have a direct effect on your brain. Am I happy your symptoms are gone? Sure, fantastic. I want you to feel great in life. But that's actually the smallest piece of the puzzle here. And we have to understand this, man. We have to understand this. So when my patient looked at me and I had to lie to him, because I hate lying to anybody, when I had to lie to him, it changed something in my own head. I sat back and I got right to this point in that Rocky movie again. Where I went back, when my patient left, I went back into my personal office, and I said to myself these exact words. I said, this will never happen to me again. I will never lie to another patient ever again. I will never have somebody ask me the power of chiropractic and to explain it and not be able to do that. So the reason I started off this talk saying that I'm a practicing chiropractor is because I need you to understand this. I don't have a diplomate in neurology. I don't have this. So if I taught myself this information, you can learn this too. You could explain it to your patients also. All right? And the one thing that we have to embrace and love about chiropractic is this. We have to embrace and love that when we are subluxated, we have a major distortion in all the structures that support that vertebrae. The way that we cause a stress response in the brain, the way that that happens is because all those supporting structures, all these guys here, the disc, the facet, the muscle, the tendon, all these supporting structures, when you have a subluxation, you have two types of stressors occurring in the body. Number one, you have a physical stressor because of all the distortion. When you have that much distortion and all those things are changing, it sends bad information to the brain. The second type of stressor you have is from inflammation. It's a chemical stressor. All the chemicals inside inflammation in your disc and your facet, all those things, again, start to cause bad information to flood the brain. Well, why is this all important? Because this is going to cause a stress response in the brain. When all this information comes up, it goes from the spine right to the area of the brain, which will release hormones into the system, and that's the hypothalamus. Now, I know some of you guys probably haven't heard of the hypothalamus in a while. Some of my students are like, I just learned this last week. I love you guys. You're great. I need you to always remember this. The hypothalamus does one important thing in the body. It connects the nervous system to the hormone system. It connects the nervous system to the hormone system. You see, the nervous system works by two ways, electricity and chemicals. Electricity and chemicals. It's an electrical stimulus right off the top. You need an electrical charge, a start point. But the way that a behavior happens in the body, the way your body responds to that electricity is by chemicals being released. Now, depending on the chemical, will depend on what happens to the body. So if I release stress hormones, stress chemicals, then your body's gonna react a certain way. You'll get all tense and all crazy. You ever have those patients walk into your office like this, and you're like, oh, just relax. And you're like, well, I am relaxed. Right? But they're in a, they really look like they want to punch somebody out, right? That is a person in a stressed state. So the first stressor that starts to come out, I don't want you to worry about the name of these systems. I want you to worry about the end results. When you have that negative information coming up, you have adrenaline being released, and you have, can we get the next slide, brother? And then we have cortisol being released. So we have adrenaline and cortisol, adrenaline and cortisol. Remember those two things. What is so important about adrenaline and cortisol? Because people always ask me this all the time. They're like, but John, isn't the stress response good? I mean, it's an innate response in the body, no? Listen to me, never forget this. The stress response is good for you short term. Do you understand that concept? Short term, you need stress hormones. If I had a gun to your head right now and I said, you better start running before I pull the trigger. You have 10 seconds to run before I pull the trigger. You need stress hormones. Why do you need stress hormones? Because stress hormones give you behaviors. Stress hormones give you behavior. So what's the behavior I get from a stress hormone? I'm going to prepare your body to either kill whatever's in front of you or you're going to run away. So if I get a gun to your head, guess what? You need stress hormones. Why? Because stress hormones bring blood to the muscles, the brain, and the heart. Muscles, brain, heart. Now that's a good news short term. Because if you gotta run away from me, I need blood in my muscles. I need blood in my heart. I need blood in my brain so I can run away. You with me on this? But guess what? There's only so much blood in your body. There's only so much blood in your body. Would you agree with me on this? So if I give to muscles, heart, and brain, I gotta take from somebody. I gotta take from somebody. So who do I take from? Reproduction, digestion, and the immune system. Reproduction, digestion, and the immune system. And short term, that is a good deal for you. Short term, it's a good deal. Because guess what? If you don't survive the next 5 minutes, does it really matter if you can reproduce? Does it really matter if your GI system can digest that sandwich you had for lunch? It doesn't really matter if you can't survive the next 5 minutes. Right? So the stress response short term is good. It's the long term release of these hormones, the long term repeated release of these hormones that is toxic to the body. If that stress response turns into a long-term thing, now those same hormones that saved you short-term will poison and kill you long-term. You with me on this? So let me ask you a question. The stress response is good short-term. Why? Because once the threat is gone, once the stressor's gone, everything goes back to normal. You remember that? If I had a gun to your head and I said, you got 10 seconds to run, I'm going to stay right here, but you got 10 seconds to run before I start shooting. Bam, you're gone like a shot, right? Well, 10 seconds later, you've run 100 meters away. So you're standing behind a building now. You're like, but I'm not around you anymore. There's no gun to your head anymore. So now what's going to happen the next minute? You're going to be like, oh, good, I'm safe. I'm good. And now you're going to go back to normal because the stressor's gone. The threat is gone. So your body will go back to normal. Cool? The stress response did its job. It got you out of danger. But what if the stressor doesn't go away? What if the stressor doesn't go away? What if people are in your office and they have a terrible life? What if they have a bad marriage? What if they hate their jobs? What if they have a sick kid at home that they have to take care of? What if they have a mom who's suffering from Alzheimer's and got to take care of the mom, doesn't even recognize them anymore? What about these people who go fight in these like Iraq wars and stuff like that? They see their friend's legs blown off and their best friend's killed right in front of them. That changes their brain completely. And what I need you to understand is that the stress response from the subluxation adds to that information. I was watching a psychologist talk about the stress response on the internet. And she had a glass of water in her hands. And she said this, because she held it up. So everyone thought she was going to say, oh, is it half empty? Is it half full? All that kind of stuff, right? No. She says, how much does this weigh? So people sits back and says, 8 ounces, 10 ounces, 5 ounces. She goes, never forget this. It doesn't matter how much it weighs. It matters how long I hold it. Doesn't matter how much it weighs. It matters how long I hold it. So if this is a 5 ounce bottle of water and I'm holding it for 20 seconds, no problem at all. I hold it for 2 minutes, no problem. I hold it for an hour, now my arm's gonna start to get sore. I hold it for 2 hours, my arm's gonna start to get numb. I'm gonna have a hard time gripping it. I hold it all day, it's gonna be almost impossible for me to hold the same weight of water. Do you understand me? It doesn't matter how much it weighs. It matters how long you hold it. That's what the subluxation is. Because people will constantly say this garbage to us. They'll say, well, it's only a millimeter of change. How much pressure can it actually have? How much you're... It doesn't matter how much it's subluxated. It matters how long it's been there. How long has bad information been flooding the brain of the patient? Because that's no different than holding that 5 ounce bottle of water. At first, it's no big deal. So if she was subluxated for 2 minutes, not a problem. If she was subluxated earlier that day, walked into your office and got adjusted, that's been taken care of now, no problem. If I've been subluxated for 25 years, I've been getting bad information flooding the brain, sending stress hormones into my body for 25 years now. This is a completely different problem now. Can we understand those concepts? You understand me? Because people will always sit back and they'll say, oh, but John, it's just a subluxation. You're saying the subluxation caused all these things? The subluxation is that last tennis ball. If you're juggling a bunch of different tennis balls and you're like, oh, I can juggle 10 tennis balls. I'm pretty awesome with this. At some point in time, someone's going to throw you another tennis ball where you can't quite catch that last one and everything will drop out of your hands. That's what the subluxation is. It's adding to the stress response. Your brain's getting flooded with toxic information. This is why you go into this posture. All of our patients walk into our office like this, right? They lose their posture and they look like this. Why is this? Why do you walk into a chiropractic office like this? Do you guys understand this? Because I need to really drive this home for you. Because if you think like I thought, where, oh, it's because you're in front of a computer all day. Okay, so you're like this. So because you're in front of a computer, you see the C motion, you're basically training all these patterns. If you're thinking that the way I thought it, we were 100% wrong. We are 100% wrong. Do you know what puts your body in this position? Your brain. When your brain gets bad information sent to it, it says, I need to protect the body. So how do I protect the body? I put it in a flexed position. Think about it. If I had a baseball bat in my hand right now and I walked up and threatened to hit you, what would you do? Right? If I actually did hit you and you went to the ground and I threatened to hit you again, what would you do? You'd go into a fetal position, right? You'd go more and more into flexion, more and more into a ball. So let's back away on the intensity. If I'm sending bad information to the brain's still going to try to protect you. So what does it do? It puts you in a flexed presentation. Let me ask you a question. Do people's posture improve in your office, yes or no? Yes. Did they quit their job? They didn't quit their job, did they? So they're still in front of the computer every day, aren't they? You with me? Being in front of a computer, it continuously keeps sending that bad information to the brain, but it's an aggravating factor. It's not a causative factor. The causative factor is the brain saying, I need to protect myself because I'm so much under stress, I have to change the behavior of the body. So if I can't go run or I can't beat up somebody, it says, protect yourself. Boom, I'll do this. Right? So I want to introduce you to this. Now I want to tee up a video for you so that you can actually see the power of the nervous system. Because remember, the nervous system is electricity and chemicals. Electricity and chemicals. Can we get that video, guys? Thanks, brother. Now, everything starts in the brain. Everything starts in the brain. So we start off as an electrical stimulus. See all the electricity, all those flashes? That's electricity. That's your nervous system starting everything off. It says, let's prep the nerve. Why do I need to prep the nervous system? Because I'm going to prep it with the type of chemicals I'm going to release on the other end. The way that one nerve communicates with another nerve is it has to release chemicals between them. So I have to prep the type of chemicals I want. So when it gets to the end of a nerve now, when it gets to the end of a nerve, watch this. I have to communicate with another nerve. So see all these little balls here? These are all hormones. See all those hormones, those neurotransmitters, all those chemicals? They go and they pass through and they communicate with the other nerve. Now, if these little hormones are things like adrenaline, things like cortisol, I'm gonna have stress behaviors at the end of that. If those little balls are things like dopamine, things like serotonin, then I'm gonna have relaxation and happiness at the end of that. You're starting to understand that chemicals equal behavior at the end. When someone's off in your office, that means certain chemicals were released to give you that behavior. When someone's happy-go-lucky and want to give you a big hug, that's different chemicals that are releasing that behavior. You with me on this so far? Good. So I need to now introduce how chiropractic affects these hormones. Because if you can understand the hormones, if you can understand the nervous system and how it communicates with this stuff, then we can start to see how it comes up into our office. So now, the first area of the brain I want to talk about is something called the hippocampus, part of the learning experience. So you may have experienced something like this in your life. Have you ever been walking through a public place? Have you ever walked through a mall and you walk past somebody who has the identical cologne or perfume of an old boyfriend or girlfriend and you instantly thought of that last person, right? You're like, oh yeah, that was John 2010. He was great, right? Like you instantly, right? You instantly went right back to that person, right? Or you heard a song and it brought you right back to high school. Like, you can instantly go back to that. Why? Because the area of your brain that burns memories into your mind is linked in to smell and hearing, okay? This is called the hippocampus. Why is the hippocampus so important? Because this area of the brain gets damaged by stress hormones. So when you have all kinds of cortisol, cortisol goes to the hippocampus and damages it. So you got the one stress hormone that the subluxation is involved with constantly leaking into your body, and the more that leaks into your body, the more it goes to the area of the brain for memory and learning and starts to damage it. Show of hands for me, please. Show of hands. How many of us chiropractors have had special needs kids come into our office, or kids with learning disabilities, or kids with behavioral issues, or whatever it is? They've walked into your office, started chiropractic care, and all of a sudden those behaviors have changed. Show of hands. Take a look around the room. Please, keep those up. Take a look around the room. Is this a coincidence? Seriously, is this a coincidence? Of course not. But why, though? Why? It's not because C2 has a hookup to the brain. Do you understand me? Why we are so powerful is every time you adjust someone, it doesn't matter where the area of subluxation is. If you stop, because remember, these supporting structures, the disc, the facet, the muscle, the tendon, these are hooked up everywhere. It doesn't matter if this is C1, S1, L5, it doesn't matter. The area of subluxation will send bad information to the brain, which releases cortisol. When that cortisol goes up to the hippocampus, it will start to damage the area of memory and learning. By removing the subluxation, you stop the cortisol release so that you can stop the damage to the hippocampus. So just so that you know, this isn't just John Minardi, you know, tooting about this. Padashi did a study on this in 2010. Whalen did a study on this in 2002 and showed every time you adjust people, you decrease cortisol in the blood. Are you understanding me on this? Why then is this so important? Because if we can show that we decrease cortisol, then what's the subluxation? If we're decreasing stress hormones, what's the subluxation? Stress. The subluxation is causing stress to the brain, because if we remove it and we decrease stress hormones, this is causing stress to the brain. Now, memory and learning is also involved with the environment that you're in. So depending on the environment that you're in, that's going to have a direct effect on memory and learning, okay? So I'm going to give you an example. They did a great study with monkeys, okay? Now, before someone says that's not a monkey, that's a chimpanzee, I know, you're too smart for your own good, but I Googled monkey, and that's the picture who came up, okay? So that's why I'm using this guy. But they did a classic monkey study, and I'm sure some of you guys have heard of this, but they basically did this. They put four monkeys into a cage, and inside that cage, they put a ladder, and on top of the ladder, they put bananas. Okay, so every time the monkeys would go into the cage, they would notice the bananas, climb up the ladder, start to eat the bananas, okay? But the researchers did this. Every time one of the monkeys tried to go get bananas, they sprayed the other monkeys with freezing cold water. So the monkeys figured out quickly that when somebody walks up the ladder, we're going to get sprayed with water. So anybody who went up the ladder, they beat them up, okay? So very quickly, these four monkeys figured out you can't go up the ladder or you're going to take a beating, okay? They all figured out the rules. So then the researcher replaced one of the monkeys. They took out a monkey and they put it in a new monkey. So now you got three old monkeys, one new monkey. The new monkey walks into the environment, says, bananas. He thinks, I'm going to go eat some bananas. He tries to go up the ladder. What happens to him? They get beat up. He gets beat up, okay? So he's like, I don't know why I'm getting beat up, but I'm not going to go up the ladder anymore because he's figured out I'm going to get beat up every time I do. Then they replaced another monkey. So now you got two old monkeys, two new monkeys. The newest monkey walks in, same thing, tries to go up the ladder, get the bananas. Everybody beats him up, including the first new monkey, right? Why not, right? You're winning Rome, beat him up. I got beat up, why not beat up him, right? So now, they replaced another monkey. So now you got one old monkey, three brand new monkeys. And the newest monkey walks in, same thing. Goes up the ladder, everybody beats him up, including the next two monkeys, right? Last but not least, they take out the last monkey. Now they replace that last monkey. So you got four completely new monkeys. Not one has been sprayed with water. Not one. When the newest monkey comes in, goes up the ladder, what happens to him? He gets beat up by the other three monkeys. Now remember, not one of these monkeys has ever been sprayed with water. Not one. So if I took one of those monkeys, if a monkey could talk, if I took one of those monkeys and said, why are you beating up somebody when they walk up the ladder? What would they say to me? What would they say to me? They'd say, I don't know. That's just what we do around here. Right? Think about that. Because they learn through their environment, because they actually do not know. Not one of them has been sprayed with water, so it's not like they can explain to you, oh, I beat him up because if not, I'll get sprayed with water. They have no idea why they beat the guy up. They just know that they beat him up if they walked up the ladder. Simple as that, right? So here's the thing. I've talked about this study for years, but do you know that they did a very similar study with humans? Just recently, you may have seen it on Facebook, but I posted on my Facebook page. If you ever want to go check out my Facebook page, you can see it. But they did it with humans, and what they did was this. They had a female walk into a dentist office, okay, and she sat down in the waiting area, and there was five or six other actors in the waiting room, okay? So she doesn't know she's an actor, but these are all actors in the waiting room. And every 20, 30 seconds or so, they would ring a little bell. And every time they rang the bell, all the actors would stand up, and then they'd sit back down. So you can see the girl, who's not an actor, doesn't know what the heck's going on. So every time the bell would go off, everybody'd stand up and say, she'd look around and be like, the heck are you guys doing, right? Then the bell will go off again, ding, ding, ding. Everybody starts standing up. So she's like, feverishly starting to stand up. She's like, well, I don't even know why I'm doing this, but okay, that's fine. Sits back down. Every time the bell rang now, everybody stood up. She'd stand up just as fast as everybody else. And she's like, I know the rules now. I got to stand up every time the bell happens. So as it goes now, the actors are going to get seen by the dentist. So one by one, the actors go get to see the dentist, but the bell is still going off. The person who's not an actor is still standing up and down. Now there's nobody else in the waiting room except her. Except her. Bell goes off. What does she do? Stands up, sits back down. Okay? Now another person walks into the dentist's office, not an actor. Walks into the dentist's office, grabs a magazine, starts reading. Bell goes off. She gets up, sits down. He looks at her and goes, what the heck? Right? Bell goes off again. She stands up. He looks at her and says, why are you standing up? Her answer? Everybody else was doing it earlier, so I thought I was supposed to. His response? Oh, okay. Stands up. Sits back down. Bell goes off again. They both, in unison, stand up, sit back down. Another person walks in, not an actor. Again, bell goes off. These two stand up. The gentleman now looks at the guy who just walked in and says, you need to stand up every time they ring the bell. His response? Okay. He gets up. They go on and on for the next 5 minutes of new people walking into this office. Everybody is brand new, not an actor. They look around and everybody's standing up and down by a bell. Why? Because we learn based on what's happening in our environment. And more times than not, no one questions why. Think about that. And then ask yourself this question. Why do you think so many people get vaccinated? Ask yourself this question. In your office, has anyone ever said this? I have weighed the pros and cons of both vaccination and non-vaccination, and I have found through my research that vaccination is the way to go. So I would like to do that. Have you ever heard that ever? What do our parents say to us when we say something like, oh, well, why did you vaccinate? Just out of curiosity. Because that's one of my questions in my report. If someone says, you know, here's my child, it's all beat up, I don't know what's going on, blah, blah. One of my questions on my report form is this. What medications are you on? And then I'll ask if it's a newborn, I'll say, did he or she receive their vaccines? Okay? And 99.9% of the time, I hear yes. And I'll say, okay, excellent. Why did you vaccinate? That's my next question. I don't say it like, why did you vaccinate? You're so stupid. I don't do that. I say, why did you vaccinate? Not once have I heard, oh, because it's for the health of my child. I've done all the research and I want to have it. Their answer, 99.9% of the time, is this. I thought I had to. Everybody told me I had to. Right? So you may think to yourself, holy cow, people just don't even question? Yes, that's exactly what I'm telling you. People in an environment, if we have 100 people in this room, if 99 of you stood up when that one person walked into the room, if every time I clicked my hands, everybody stood up, if a person walked into this room and I clicked my hands and you all stood up, what do you think that person would do? No, I choose to stay, sit. Like, that doesn't happen. No one wants to question. You wanna know why? No one wants to stick out. No one wants to stick out, except for us. Chiropractors stick out like crazy, but that's why people think we're nuts, and we are kind of nuts. But the thing is that's why, because you go against the grain. But remember this, the reason it's difficult and the reason our challenge is so great for humanity is because we are trying to teach them things that is 100% against what the environment they've been in their entire life. So that's why from day one, you have to educate people that we are more than pain, because for the past X amount of years that they've been alive, all they've been conditioned with is if you have no pain, you have no what? You have no problem. That's what they're conditioned with. And if you ask them, why do you say that? They actually do not have an answer for you. They've just heard it their whole life. You guys with me on this? You have to understand this. And that's why I'm like a Nazi when I come onto this stuff. I'm like, you gotta talk about the brain. Do you wanna know why? Because if people all we give people is bone pressure on nerve equals bad, if that's all we give them, then they never understand the power of chiropractic. They never understand that we affect the brain. And if they don't understand that we affect the brain, they'll never fully understand why they need wellness care. They'll never fully understand why chiropractic has a global health benefit to their body. They'll never get it, because we have to teach it to them. You with me on this? You understand? Do you want to know why? I was just reading this other book on a brain, and I read this other study, which was real cool. And when I read the study, I'm like, man, this is chiropractic, you know? See, we cling on to that bone pressure on nerves so hard because we're like, oh, man, I don't want to lose this. I don't want to lose it. It's mine. If I give it away, I don't know what I'm going to get. So I read the study, right? They had monkeys, and they do a lot of stuff with monkeys. They had a bunch of monkeys. Now, monkeys, they had these two treats for monkeys. Now, they like both treats, but they prefer one more than the other. So they had this frozen juice box, and then they had this jar of peanut butter, okay? So if I presented both to a monkey, they like both. If I just gave them one or the other, they'd like it, but they prefer the peanut butter, okay? They prefer it. So here's the thing you got to remember. If, however, I gave a monkey a juice box, he grabs it, he likes it. But if I say to him, trade with me, now I have peanut butter, and I say, trade me the juice box for the peanut butter, they would not do it. If you gave them the choice, which one do you want, they'll take peanut butter. But if you already gave them something and said, trade me, they will not trade, because they kind of like the juice box. I like the peanut butter better, but I have the juice box. So I don't really trust you, and if I give you the juice box, I might lose both, and that sucks, right? Right? So the thing is I looked at this and I said, this is chiropractic. We want brain, but we have pressure on nerve, right? We want peanut butter, but we don't want to give up our freaking juice box, right? This is it, and it drove me freaking crazy, right? It drove me crazy. You got to give up what's not working. And you want to know why it isn't working long term? Because it isn't what we do. It isn't what we do. We don't take pressure off nerve. We recalibrate the brain. I don't know if you are you guys. Do you guys know the recent work from Heidi Havoc that showed that every time you adjust the spine, you have an increased activation of the prefrontal cortex by at least 20 up to 55%. And these are non-pain patients, people who have no pain at all. Every time you adjust them, you increase activity of the brain, the area of the brain that is for executive function, helps you learn, helps you make decisions properly, all that kind of stuff. You increase activation of that area. This is also the area of the body, if you know the brain at all, that increases antibodies released in the blood. I have a whole course just on the immune system itself, and I show how chiropractic, through research, increases antibodies in the blood. Why? Because we have a direct effect on the brain. I always start off with this course. This is like my introduction course so that you understand, what do we do with the body and the brain? So now, the next hormone I need to talk about is one called dopamine. Now, dopamine, this is an anticipation hormone. Anticipate. You ever anticipate anything in your life? You ever really want something? You're like, oh, man, I can't wait for that. That's dopamine being released, okay? Now, dopamine, you need the right amount of dopamine. Too much dopamine, no good. Too little dopamine, no good. You need the right amount. And if you have a lack of dopamine in your body, you will do dangerous things to release dopamine. So you will jump out of a perfectly good airplane. Okay? You'll go bungee jumping. You'll get a motorcycle and fly down the road. You'll do dangerous things. You'll put yourself into danger to get that rush. You ever hear people like, oh, I'm an adrenaline junkie? No, you're a dopamine junkie. Get your drugs right. Okay? You're a dopamine junkie. Adrenaline kicks in way later. Dopamine is the release in the brain that gives you that high, like, oh, I can't, thank you. It gives you that high where you're like, oh, man, I can't wait. That's dopamine. Why is it so important? Because if dopamine drops, not only will you get things like depression, and not only will you get things like I'm ticked off at life, when dopamine drops physically in the body, you get a loss of controlled movement, a loss of controlled movement. So if you've ever heard of someone who has Parkinson's disease, Parkinson's has a lack of dopamine. So what happens to the arm of a Parkinson's patient? They're always like this, right? They're always moving. They can't control that arm. Okay. So if I was a little kid and I'm moving around a lot, and I'm fidgety and I can't, what would you call me? What would you call me? I'm hyperactive, right? See, ADHD, I have a whole course on that too, but let me give you a little snippet of it. ADHD, the theory behind ADHD is you're not getting enough dopamine release, because one of the things dopamine does is increase concentration, okay? So it says you're not getting enough dopamine release, so it must be that your receptors of your brain for dopamine are not releasing enough, so they must be broken. So we're gonna give you these drugs to release more dopamine from the brain. But I need you to really understand this. It is not because the receptors on the brain for dopamine release are broken. That's not true. DeCampo in 2013 proved that was not true. What is it then, John? It's because cortisol sends a signal to dopamine that says do not release. Can't release and someone giving you a signal saying don't release are two totally different things. ADHD kids don't have a problem with dopamine. They have a problem with cortisol, because as soon as I remove the cortisol, studies show dopamine increases and the behavioral stuff goes away. You guys understand me on this? Well, why is it so important? Because if you're subluxated, what does it release? It releases more cortisol. So if you release cortisol, it's gonna stop, it's gonna decrease dopamine. And if I decrease dopamine, what behavior is gonna happen to a little kid? You're gonna have ADHD. What behavior is gonna happen with an adult? You are gonna have depression. You're gonna have someone who's unhappy. You're gonna have someone who's ticked off. You ever have I have a patient in my office. When he first started coming in, his name was Lloyd. And I'd say, Lloyd, how are you today, buddy? His standard response every single time was this, the shits. That was just it. How you doing today? The shits. I'm like, something happened? No, it's just my usual. That's how he felt every single day. Every single day, his normal, his common was I feel crappy. So that's normal for me. You understand? You ever have people walk into your chiropractic office, they've been adjusted by you for years and years and years, and they don't have any pain or anything, but if I walked up to any of those patients and asked them, why do you keep coming to, you know, Dr. Tony's clinic? What do they say? They don't even know. They don't even know. They'd sit back and say, I can't put my finger on it, but I just love being here. I can't put my finger. Do you have any pain? No, I haven't had pain for years. I've been under care for 20 years. No pain. No. How come you keep coming? They say, I don't know, I love it. I love it here. I love how it makes me feel. What the heck are they talking about? They're talking about these hormones that are being released. Every time you adjust people, you release these type of hormones. And the last one I'm gonna talk about real quick before I gotta get off the stage. See, I could talk about this all day. You should have booked me for 12 hours, you know what I mean? And then I could just go all day long. But the last one I wanna talk about is serotonin. Now serotonin, very similar to dopamine, this is a satisfaction hormone. You're satisfied, you feel content. That's satisfaction, okay? Serotonin, again, is decreased by cortisol. If you have too much of that stress hormone inside your body, guess what cortisol does? It decreases it. So if you have a lot of cortisol and you decrease serotonin, that's people who start to get depressed. People who start to get just, I hate life. All that's serotonin dropping down. So here's a patient base that always has a problem with this. You ever have people who walk in and they're like, I got fibromyalgia. You ever have those? Why? Because serotonin is plummeting in them. And when serotonin plummet, inflammation starts to increase like crazy. Because never forget this, every time, why is this so important? Because it's a cytokine that triggers the inflammatory response. Soon as stress hormones get released, you automatically are inflamed, automatically. So what boosts serotonin? Do you know what people immediately go to because they feel crappy? What boosts it for them temporarily? Sugar. So they reach for something sweet. You ever see somebody who's having a bad day? I hate life, where's my chocolate? Right, like they want something to boost it. Now but the only problem is that's short term. So they boost it and then they're like, oh, I feel crappy again. So now I'm gonna go back to the refrigerator. You with me on this? But you know what else boosts the chiropractic adjustment boosts serotonin? How does the chiropractic adjustment boost serotonin? Because again, you stop cortisol release. So if you stop cortisol release, then cortisol allows serotonin to do what it's supposed to do. In your offices, do I have any CAs in here? Oh, I love you CAs, I love you. What else boosts serotonin? A positive CA at the front. That's why you need to have good people, orientated people at the front. Why? Because listen, the chiropractor is the middleman, right? Chiropractor is the middleman. Patient walks in, who do I see first? CA. So guess what? If you got a great CA at the front, if someone walks into if I walk into your office and your CA is like, John, I love your suit, man, you look good. How's your dog? We love your dog. I feel great. I haven't done anything yet, right? Haven't even got my adjustment yet, but I feel good being there, right? But if you got a dragon lady at the front, right? You got a dragon lady at the front, man. You come in, you're like, I hate you. You're 5 minutes late. John's already behind. Sit down, we'll get to you. I'm like, I hate this place. Right? You're like, You could be the best adjuster in the history of the world. If you got a crappy CA at the front, no one's gonna get better under your care. No one's gonna get better under your care. Do you wanna know why? They won't like coming to your office. And that hormone release will override everything that you do. I gotta finish up here because I'm done. But listen to me, I could go on and on. If you want to learn more about this, I got multiple courses on this. I'll be outside at the little table. You can come talk to me. But please, for my students in this audience and for all my practicing doctors, never underestimate how powerful you are as a chiropractor. Never underestimate how powerful you are. Let me leave you with my favorite quote of all time, okay? It's from Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great said this. His generals walked up to him, about to invade a place. And they had 10,000 people in their army. And these guys only had 1,000. So the generals walk up to Alexander and let's kill these guys, it's easy. Alexander says, no, we have to be cautious. We have to take caution with these people. So they looked at him and they said, what? We can kill these guys, we have 10 times the people. And he said, no, we have to be cautious. This is a different army. So someone says, are you afraid? Alexander the Great says, are you afraid? Alexander the Great looks at him and says, never forget this. I'm not afraid of an army of lions if they're led by a lamb. But I am afraid of an army of lamb if they're led by a lion. Lead like lions, and we can change this entire world. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
John Minardi!